Tonight's keynote speaker is the head coach of the reigning NCAA basketball national champion, Louisville Cardinals. He was born and raised in New York City, and he began to fuel his passion for the game of basketball as a standout guard at his local high school before going to the University of Massachusetts to play there. He went on to a successful coaching career where he has coached at 5 different schools and became the first person to win the national championship at 2 different schools, Louisville and Kentucky. He has sparked action by sharing his successes and failures through his acclaimed books, Success is a Choice and Lead to Succeed. Let's turn our attention to the screens as we learn a little bit more about tonight's keynote speaker. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the stage, Mr. Rick Pitino.
Thank you. Thank you. And welcome to Louisville. We appreciate everything that you do and what you're all about. This morning, I had 4 practices in between class time for the players. Then came back and spoke to another group. Then came and had an afternoon, evening practice, and then came back. And someone asked me, are you tired? I said, no, because I learned something a long time ago. I was speaking to a group of young people, and we had a Q&A at the end. And they asked me an interesting question. They said, if you were 21 back in college, knowing what you know today, what would you tell us? And I thought that was a great question. And I said, I wish I had tomorrow's newspaper to tell you some of the things that would go on in the future. But in terms of the past and what I would learn, I'll give you a quick synopsis of what I believe that every time you go to work, what I call in my job, between the lines, that you've got to be passionate and positive. And it started for me in a different realm altogether than you. See, I grew up with tall buildings on the east side of Manhattan. No grass, very little greenery, but I had a dream come true. At a young age, I was named the head coach of the New York Knicks, the team I rooted for as a child. And I was so excited, so passionate, so positive. And then, we're gonna snap 30 games into the season, we're going to snap the Boston Celtic home consecutive victory record of 31. We won 30 straight games at Madison Square Garden, and the year prior to that, 2 years prior, they won 23 and 24 games. So this was a great moment, and we're playing the Los Angeles Lakers. Just came back from a West Coast trip where we played Seattle, Phoenix, LA, came back, Chicago, Milwaukee, came home, won 3 out of 5, and we were in first place. The driver, I lived out in the country, and the driver picked me up and said, Coach, you look terrible. I said, it was a long road trip, Walter, but I'm so fired up. Tonight, we're going to snap the Celtic streak of 31 consecutive victories. He said, well, look, close your eyes. We got a 45-minute drive. When we get close, I'll wake you up. Would you like to listen to some music? Sure, Walter, anything you'd like. Hey, coach, you want to listen to the hottest thing out? I said, what's that? He said, WFAN, All Sports Talk Radio. Now remember, this is about 30 some odd years ago. I said, well, what do they do? Well, they call in. Coach, they're always speaking about you. So I said, you know what, Walter? Everybody likes to hear some nice words once in a while. Yeah, sure, turn it on. First caller. Now remember, we're in first place. 30 in a row. Go ahead, Vinny from Bensonhurst, you're on the fan. Hey, the coach of the Knicks, Pitino. Yeah, first place, right? No, they should fire him right away. The players are gonna have no legs for the playoffs, he presses too much. Immediately, I woke up, I put my neck on the front seat. I said, Walter, did he say I should be fired? He said he did, coach. Next caller, Mike from Bay Ridge, go ahead, you're on the fan. I couldn't agree with Vinny more. They shoot way too many three-point shots. They should fire the coach now. Well, I couldn't believe what I was hearing. And I said to Walter, does this go on every day? He said, actually, coach, they're pretty good to you. You should hear what they say about the Jet and Giant football teams, the head coaches and their wives. So it was the first introduction for me into the negative, cynical world. And for the next 2 weeks, because in New York you're always stuck in traffic, I listened to what I later coined the fellowship of the miserable. All these cynical, negative people. And I noticed one thing that happened to me listening to this for a half hour. I got out of the automobile and I felt bad. I didn't like what they were saying about other coaches, what they were saying about me. No different than what you have to go through sometimes on Facebook or other social medias. That's what you go through today. You see the cynics, you see the negative people. Well, I said, that's it. I wasn't going to work in an upbeat, positive mood, ready to attack the Dave's problems, ready to make my team better between the lines. So now for 30 plus years, I never again turned on talk radio, ever again. I turn away and turn off and totally tune them out, cynical, negative people. I surround myself with upbeat, positive people because it raises the tide tremendously. So that would be my first piece of advice to you if I was your age. Turn out the negative. Turn off the cynical. Turn on the upbeat, positive people and surround yourself with those people because they raise up everybody's abilities. The second thing I would talk about is about a book I've just written. It's been out 3 weeks now, called One Day Contract. See, 2 years ago, we lost an NCAA game, got upset by a local school called Morehead State. And they deserved the victory. We lost our best player, up a few points with 8 minutes to go, he broke his ankle, and they upset us. And I thought for the first time about stepping out of the game I love, my passion, and go into broadcasting. I had a good run, and I thought about it and said, you know what? I'm letting a loss get me down, and I'm running from the challenges that lie ahead. I rationalized by saying, I'm still gonna be in it. I'll go into something else because of failure. All of you are going to fail. How do you treat failure? Failure is fertilizer to help future things grow in your lifetime. Don't worry about the adversity. Handle it with courage. It's fertilizer. You're going to fail, but you must learn from it and grow even better from it. So I decided to change and rebrand myself by writing this book. It all started with a group of guys, Wall Street financial brokers, around a table after a game, and I was the Knick coach. And it came across the ticker that a player from the Atlanta Hawks was offered $21 million for 7 years, and he averaged 2 points a game. These Wall Street brokers said to me, "That's what's wrong with your game. You're paying a guy $7 million for averaging 2 points." I said, "Well, it's based on potential. Obviously, they think he'll be a lot better." They said, "No. You see, in our industry, one bad trade, and we're fired. We live on a one-day contract." So for the last 25 years, I've thought about that. And that's the title of the book. And I said, I'm going to rebrand myself, because I was getting close to 60 years of age, and I wanted to be just as passionate at 60 as I was as a Knick coach at 30. So I said, I have to be more positive every single day. And I have a routine. The night before, meticulous preparation. Now remember, if all of you have one day, and today I'm going to try to sign you on to this one-day contract. So tonight, you're going to go to bed, and you're going to have meticulous preparation for the next day. When you wake up, you're going to listen to music on the way to work. Listen to your favorite band or whatever group you like to listen to. For me, this is going to sound extremely strange to you, but I live part-time in Miami, and I'm a Pitbull fan. So I listen to Armando Christian Perez Pitbull every morning. I drive to work. I'm in there at 6:45, and I start focusing in between the lines. You have to have laser-sharp focus, and you can't get distracted throughout the day, because all of you have much more talent than I had at your age. So you're going to fall into certain traps, though, along the way, because remember, I'm giving you advice that when I was your age, knowing what I know now. So here's what I have to tell you. This is an addictive piece of equipment. I know 2 years ago I was addicted. So when I started the one-day contract, I said, I'm going to play certain rules, because I was constantly in the company of other people taking out my phone because it was buzzing off. And then I realized I was insulting everybody. But then I watched everybody I was with, and they were taking out the phone looking at their messages. And I said, I'm going to have rules on this one-day contract, that when I meet someone, you're the most significant person in my life. I would never insult you by taking out my phone and saying to you, excuse me 1 second, this message is much more important than what you're saying. So I never do that anymore. When I'm in the company of people, you are the most important people in my life. And here's an interesting story, because before the cell phone, I was the coach of Kentucky at a Final Four. And apparently, a young coach came up from another country. And he told me he coached women's basketball. And he said, I want to learn about your full court press. Now, I was really busy. Our team was in the Final Four. And I said, well, let me sit down with you. Let me take you through the press. I've got about 20 minutes if I can get through to you. He said, boy, that's so nice of you. You're going to take 20? I said, I want to teach you this press. You seem like you want to learn it. So I gave him my undivided attention. He was from another country. I didn't know who he was, and he was coaching a different sport in terms of men's and women's. We sat down. I said, do you have a feel for it now? He said, yeah, I can't thank you enough. I shook his hand and moved on. 30-some-odd years later, I didn't think I'd ever see this person again. And by the way, I never have. But I got a phone call in May. This gentleman, apparently, and I still haven't met him, has become one of the wealthiest men in the world. And he's no longer coaching women's basketball. He owns a team. And the person who was calling me said he wants to offer you the general manager's job of this professional team. And I laughed. I said, obviously, he never saw me run the presidency with the Boston Celtics, or he wouldn't have offered that job to me. And he said, no, he remembers you spending 20 minutes with him when he was an unknown women's coach and never has forgotten that in his life. So as a young person at 60, I'm telling you now, never, ever take anyone for granted who you meet. Leave a lasting impression. Whether it's 5 minutes, 10 minutes, 15 or 20, do a commercial on who you are and what you're all about to that person. And don't get distracted. You are the generation of the distracted. They could call my generation something a lot worse, but you're distracted by the phone. Turn it off when you're out to dinner. When my team goes to dinner, if I catch them reading Twitter or texting someone, I take it away for 24 hours. Now, I have to tell you, if you miss a class with our team, you run the next morning at 6 a.m. for 45 minutes. If you're late 15 minutes to a class, you run for 15 minutes. Now, that's pretty difficult. You got to get up at 5. If I take that phone away for 24 hours, it's much worse than running at 4 in the morning for 30 days. That's how addicted they have become. So what I'm telling you now at 60, don't fall into that trap of technology. Technology is awesome. With this phone, I can get any answer I want. I can get directions. I can get ratings on restaurants. I can book my hotel. It's awesome. But there's a time and place for this phone, not when you're in the company of other people. You're between the lines when you meet people. It's your passion. Don't get distracted. The next thing I want to tell you is mastering the art of communication for all of you. I would tell you how important it is to listen 4 times to the amount you speak. Everybody loves listeners. And I learned the hard way in recruiting. See, I was recruiting this young man who I spent a lot of money on, flying back and forth to Memphis, writing him 5 times a week, calling him 5 times a week, taking private planes when I had practice to go see a game. I asked my assistant, how much money have we spent recruiting this young man? He said, 6 figures plus, coach. Well, now is D-Day to go into his home and convince him, as the front runner, the number one school in this young man's mind, to visit us and sign with us. My assistant, Billy Donovan, who today is the head coach of Florida, he was with me, and he started telling me all the things that I need to say, and I finally said, Billy, I've been in 500 homes. I'm ready. Mom, dad, brother, sister, high school coach, girlfriend. I'm ready. Well, for the next 45 minutes after I said hello, I preached about the Roman Empire, Kentucky basketball, 24,000 people every night, 56 All-Americans, national championships. Every game is on television. You don't live in a dormitory at Kentucky. You live in the Wildcat Lodge. Well, it sounded great. 45 minutes later, you could hear a pin drop. But I noticed one thing. On everybody's lap was a legal pad, and I knew they had questions on that legal pad. At the end of my 45 minutes, I said to the mom, I notice you have questions. Now, basically, it's your turn. What would you like to know? I don't know, coach. You covered it all for me. Dad? No, every question I had written down, you answered. Well, coach, you have to have some questions. No, you covered exactly how you would play. Your style, how you would use my athlete. Brother, sister, no, you answered every question. I walked out abruptly and thanked them, got in the car, and Billy said, coach, that was great. They didn't move during your speech. I said, great, Billy. I broke every rule of thumb of communication. I never formed a bond. I never built a relationship. I never listened. I never forget his answer after all these years. He said, Coach, you're reading too many of those motivational books. We're fine. We're leading with this young man. Now, you hope to get a visit, 1 of 5, and then sign the athlete. The next day we called, and after 2 years of hard work, everything went down the drain. He didn't visit us. Billy said, Coach, let's head back to Lexington. I said, no, we can't. We're going to go into the, see that next player in Brownsville, Tennessee. He said, no, Coach, we're not in his top three. It's Memphis, Tennessee, and Arkansas, and we're on the periphery. We haven't written them, haven't called them that much. I said, let's go in. Tell me who's going to be in the room. Mom, Dad, Coach, girlfriend, two brothers who played Division II basketball. I went in and I said, ma'am, I see that your son's questionnaire. He wants to study communications. She speaks for about 5 to 10 minutes how he should go into business like his two older brothers. Then I turned to the two older brothers and said, look, you guys know basketball. You played it. I'm trying to play Tony at two positions, two guard as well as one guard. The other schools are recruiting him just as a two. Each of them spoke for about 8 minutes and said, if he doesn't learn to play the point at 6'1", he has no shot at the NBA. I asked the girlfriend a question. I asked the dad a question. Turned to the high school coach and said, you know, I watched you play last year. You ran two great three-point plays. Took my magnetic clipboard out, handed it to him. Do you mind diagramming that for me? I thought those plays were great. He spent 10 minutes diagramming the plays. I said, if I get Tony, I'm going to use those plays. I asked some more questions. I laughed, I smiled, I joked around a little bit. Finally, the mom said, Coach, I'm sorry. You've been here for an hour and a half and I haven't offered you anything to drink. And by the way, would you like to stay for dinner? We're having a barbecue. Billy said, no, we got to get back, Coach, catch the plane. I said, I'd love to. We stayed 2 hours and 45 minutes, missed our flight. Got in the car, now we had to drive all the way back. 4.5 hour drive. Billy said, Coach, what was that all about? You never talked about our weight room, how many people the arena holds, how we travel. You didn't talk about anything except laughed and asked questions. I said, no, all I did, Billy, was form a relationship. I showed them the respect by listening to them, telling them they were more important than us. And by listening, I found out what not to say to the brothers. By listening, I found out what not to say to the coach. I knew exactly how to sell our program. He shook his head in disbelief. We called the next day. That weekend, that was a Tuesday, Tony Delk and his entire family, everybody in that room, visited us. He committed on Sunday. The young man from Memphis, who we were leading with, had an unfortunate accident in college, tore out his ACL, transferred schools. Tony Delk played 11 years in the NBA and was the MVP of the 1996 championship, all because of listening and finding out how to read the road signs, when to stop, when to go, when to proceed with caution, just by listening. So if you truly want to master the art of communication, which is so important, you listen 4 times to the amount you speak, then you know exactly how to sell. So we have focus, laser sharp. We don't fall into the trap of technology. We understand that. And now we know how to master the art of communication. Certainly the ability to listen and then to articulate the right way. Then adversity crops up with your one-day contract. Somewhere throughout that day, adversity comes into your life in some way. Handle adversity the following way. Look at it square in the eye. Don't make excuses. Don't point fingers at others. Look at it with great courage. And then be honest. Be honest, because once you tell the truth, any problems you have become part of your past. If you lie or distort the truth, they become part of your future. Now, sometimes in my lifetime, telling the truth is not easy, but it's the best way It's the courageous way to handle adversity. Have courage. Look it square in the eye and put it behind you. Shrink the negative and adversity down to the size of a pea. As we move forward, now we understand what all of you already have, and you could teach me, is unbelievable passion. You know, I had a walk-on on my team, and he said to me, "Coach, I'm not going to be a pro, and I don't know what I want to do in my life." He was from Georgia. And I said, "You ever think of Wall Street going on to, because you're a business major?" He said, "Nah, Coach, I don't know if I'd like to live in New York City." I said, "It's great. You get three roommates. You pay $5,000 a month rent, and you all share it. You all live in a one bedroom, and it's great. It's like a fraternity." He said, "Really? That much money?" I said, "Nah, you can get one for $3,000, but you may not have hot water many days." And I said, "No, I'm only kidding. You'll have hot water." So I flew to New York, and I met with five people that were running Merrill Lynch, Payne Webber, and so on, to try and get an interview for Brad. And I got two interviews, and one was quite interesting. This gentleman was an elderly gentleman from Rye, New York, and I walked in his back room and saw 200 people sitting next to each other in these little cubicles, trading equities and bonds, yelling out things, and I said, "Wow." His name was Mario Gabelli, and I said, "Mario, I tried to sound intelligent. Where do you get these young people from? University of Chicago? Wharton School? Princeton? Harvard Business School?" He said, "No, I look for PhDs." I said, "Really? For Wall Street, you look for PhDs?" He said, "I look for poor, hungry, and driven people. I don't care where they get their education." And that hit home with me, and he offered an interview as well as two of the other companies. They said to me, "Coach, if you're willing to fly down here for your basketball player, we're willing to give him an interview." Brad is very successful now on Wall Street today. And the interesting thing about it, Brad said to me, "Why did you do that?" I said, "Well, why did you play so passionately for me for 4 years as a walk-on who never got in the game and never complained and had so much enthusiasm? Why did you do that for me?" I said, "See, Brad, we built a bridge together. And the more the bridge is crowded, the more we impact lives, the more we know we're going to be successful. See, one thing I can tell you today that I wish I knew years ago is never judge a book by its cover." Because I had a young man write me a letter at Kentucky, and he said to me, "I'd like to be a manager on your team. I want to learn about how to be a coach." I wrote him back without any thought, saying to him, "Look, at the University of Kentucky, 95% of the students are from Kentucky. You're from New Jersey. They speak a lot different. You won't understand them. Why don't you write Villanova, Seton Hall, St. John's, and those schools?" He wrote me back and said, "No, Coach, I've got great passion to learn under you." I wrote him back and said, "All right, come on." I said, "I don't know why this young man's going through all these trials and tribulations." So he was one of 10 managers. I didn't know if he'd be a coach or not. I may have prejudged him with the way I wrote that letter back. Well, he spent 4 years as a manager. Then he was a graduate assistant, learning from the bottom up, so passionate, so eager. Then he traveled with me to Boston as an assistant video guy, then assistant coach. Today, if you turn on the television, Frank Vogel's the head coach of the Indiana Pacers. It all started with a letter, something that showed passion to me. And then he followed up and wouldn't take no for an answer. And that's what you have to do. Don't take no for an answer. You have your dreams. You have your goals. Meet those challenges. Start out your day on a one-day contract. I'm signing you all to it now. Tomorrow you wake up, ultra positive. If anyone is cynical and negative, change them. Don't fall into that trap. Don't fall into the trap of technology. Don't get distracted. Be focused in on your passion, because you're going to be successful. If you fail, pick yourself up. It's just fertilizer. That's all it is, to help you grow. Understand adversity takes courage. Battle it all the time. Now, I just told you what I know at 60. What I wish for you more than anything else is to have your passion for what you do. I know my window in coaching is starting to close. I just want to be as passionate as you. Keep that passion every single day. The one-day contract is about being as good as you can be every single day, so you're extraordinary and not ordinary, and you get your contract renewed every single day. I've been that way for 2 straight years, and there's a correlation to all of this. For 2 years now, we've won back-to-back Big East championships. We've had back-to-back Final Four appearances and a national championship. And now I said I'm going to be more passionate, more positive, more focused on my one-day contract. If I can just leave you with that, just sign on for that one day. And what you'll find is you were extraordinary, over the top for that one day, and your contract was renewed. That's who I'm signing you on to. I know you're fans of probably another university. But as you wake up tomorrow, I'm the one who signed you to that letter of intent. One day, you're going to go through it, and you're going to find yourself having an extraordinary day. I wish you nothing but health, happiness, prosperity. You are the future of our country. I admire you greatly. Good luck to all of you.
Mr. Pitino, thank you for challenging FFA members to live their life by the single day contract. Thank you for sharing through your experiences how you've overcome adversity and have been able to capitalize and gain a new perspective on life because you've come through those tough times. I know that FFA members will be able to take this advice and ignite growth and change in their lives and in their communities. Please accept this gift as a token of our appreciation and a show of our gratitude for you being here with us this evening.
Thank you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, Mr. Rick Pitino.